Welcome back now for our ongoing series on Bitcoins. All through last week, we debated and discussed extensively the phenomenon around Bitcoin and whether you should consider it as a viable investment option. The government calls it a Ponzi scheme. The government is also confused whether Bitcoin is a good, a service, or a currency. This is for taxation purpose. Now, in today's episode, we are going to address your concerns about safety. How strong are the concerns of hacking if you do buy and sell Bitcoins? And we'll also be throwing open our phone lines now, and you can ask your questions to our panel of experts directly. Is investing in Bitcoin dangerous from a safety point of view, from a hacking point of view? Our phone lines are open. That's the number flashing on your screen right now. Suprita Anupam, senior journalist at Inc42, is now with us, and also Dr. Suyash Bhatt, economist and finance specialist. And Shubhajit Sengupta, CNN News 18, Shubhajit Sengupta is also with us to understand from a layman's point of view, because he only very recently has started reporting on Bitcoin and I guess is dabbling a little also in his personal capacity. So he has a first-hand experience. Now, you can call on that number, but before that, let's quickly take a round of comments. I'll begin with you, Dr. Suyash Bhatt. The one major concern that we were able to understand, you were there last week also with us, is of safety. Of how hack-proof is this system? Will I be robbed of my wealth or my money if I start investing in Bitcoins?
Right. So concept, as we discussed last time also, the whole Bitcoin concept is based on blockchain. So blockchain in principle is a hack-proof concept. In fact, once you pass an entry in it, you can't even reverse an entry. So it is so strong that to reverse an entry, you
would
have
to create
another block to be added to the blockchain. So from that perspective, it's a yes. It is next to impossible.
Okay.
Now the cases where the hacking is being reported is the transactions where you have paid in dollar or in some other currency and that account got hacked, not the Bitcoin account.
Okay.
So there's a difference in that.
Okay. Interesting. Interesting. Suprita, one moment. I think we're getting a caller. We want to keep this interactive. So we're getting a caller also and maybe hear from them, their concerns, their views.
Sure.
Soumya joins us from Hyderabad. Good evening, Soumya. Please go ahead.
So I have a concern about this Bitcoin thing.
Yeah.
So I actually read somewhere that, you know, the Bitcoin is going to, end gradually, like after some time. It is going to stop. So that's the reason the supply is going to decrease, and maybe that's the reason the demand for Bitcoin is increasing. So I just wanted to understand how that works.
Okay, fair enough. Let me take that to Suprita. Suprita, would you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. See, as far as the numbers are concerned, Bitcoin's number is limited, and that's 21 million. And right now, somewhere almost 17 million coins have been generated so far. So definitely, the supply will be less as the time goes by because of the halves. And as far as she is talking about the technology or Bitcoin part, that how are we going to see it in coming years, definitely I will support the technology at any cost. But as far as the asset or currency that debate is concerned, I will certainly prefer Bitcoin to be traded, or any cryptocurrency for that matter should be traded as currency and definitely not as an asset, if given, if the government confirms it as a legal tender. But asset, because it's not definitely going to backed by some physical physical adequate attribute, so definitely not, it should not be traded as an asset.
Okay. Okay, Shubhajit Sengupta, I want you to come in now. Share your experience of dealing with it firsthand, and also while reporting on this. See, the government has told everyone. So as far as the government's viewpoint is concerned, while it tries to figure out how should it tax people on the profits they make on Bitcoin, it is trying to tell you that this is a Ponzi scheme. We warn you. We are warning you, if you lose your money, you are at your, go fend for yourself.
See, what the government has basically done is it's made itself amply clear, so that if a scheme like this happened, like there are a lot of Ponzi schemes, which, I mean, as it happens with everything, even in Bitcoins, there are schemes where people are being robbed of by the name of pretext. Like I know of a particular case wherein someone was told that give me two. At that point of time, the price was much lesser. It was close to about 16,000 rupees per Bitcoin. Now it's gone to roughly around 10 lakhs. Mm. So, you know, at that point of time, someone was asked that give me two of your Bitcoins, I'll mine it and make it six. That's not possible. Mining is completely different, but that's how the game was played on. So, yes, there are certain dishonest financial institutions. But having said that, you know, the fact is what we are seeing, this price rise is because of the commodities trading. Mm. We have to understand that this is not the currency which has been traded, it's a commodity. Like a dollar, if you take dollar as a commodity, it will grow. If there's a demand, it will grow. If there is a fall in demand, like if there's tomorrow, US enters the war, value of dollar will go down. It has nothing to do with the technology per se. If you look into the price rise, Bitcoins was rising, it went to about 16 lakhs, it came down to 10 lakhs now in Indian currency. At this point of time, there are other Ethereum and Ripple which are going up and down. That is essentially because of the trading which is taking place around it, not the pricing. And as far as security is concerned, you know, Bitcoin exchanges are hackable. In fact,
interesting.
Bitcoin exchanges have been hacked in certain places where there has been millions of dollars which have been lost there. But what is not hackable is if you keep your Bitcoins or cryptocurrency in a hardware wallet. If you park it in a hardware wallet and separate it
from explain what you mean by a hardware wallet.
Hardware
wallet. You mean a physical wallet?
No, no. Hardware wallet is like a pen drive kind of an instrument which you fix to your computer. You take your Bitcoins and save it there.
Okay.
So if you save it
there. So if you don't keep it in the cloud,
if you don't keep it in online, it's going to remain safe.
So then what is the safety? Dr. Bhatt, do you see? I mean, if I were to believe Shubhajit, he's saying that, see, the blockchain technology may not be hackable, but the exchanges that are providing the service to you, right? The exchanges that are providing the service to the people, they are hackable.
Right.
So as an end user, this is a proposition which is hack worthy. Right. And thus I am at a loss.
Right. Right. So that's quite natural because by default, I can't buy a Bitcoin in exchange of another Bitcoin. So I have to pay in some or the other form of currency. And the moment I do that, I'll need to use some third party server for facilitating this transaction.
Yeah.
Which is why, as I said, you know, lot of people even abroad are appreciating the technology on which it works rather than the Bitcoin itself. And as a concept, it's a very interesting concept because if you go to a country like Sweden, they where 97% of transactions happen in digital, they in fact have floated their own cryptocurrency called e-krona. And you know, there it's a imagine a government printing 100 currencies, and they know exactly where who owns which currency and how many times it has changed hands. If I have that kind of information, I don't have a problem of fake currency.
So again,
I don't have a
Dr. Bhatt, you're talking about Dr. Bhatt, you're talking about the technology being foolproof. You're saying that the technology is foolproof, but the way we are dealing with that technology is not, and thus people are at a disadvantage. One moment, we've got another caller. Murli joins us from Singapore.
Right.
Hi, Murli.
Because there's no regulatory.
Hi, Murli. Can you hear me?
Hi.
Yeah. Go ahead.
This is Murli from Singapore. I'm a finance guy, basically.
Hmm.
I would like to check how these Bitcoins are supported by assets. What kind of assets are supported?
Okay, let me take that to who will like to take this? Suprita or
Dr.
Bhatt?
Who will support the Bitcoin?
Okay, Suprita. Suprita, what is the asset that supports a Bitcoin?
Okay. Hello.
Yeah, Suprita. So there is a question that is being asked. What is the asset that supports the Bitcoin?
Yeah, exactly. That's my concern because it's not currently it's not being backed by any physical attribute. So my point is that the interface is very weak between the crypto between cryptocurrency Bitcoin or other cryptocurrency and the conventional currency. So interface is very weak. We have just now we have seen Bitcoin futures are coming up. And definitely not up to the mark because of the regulations, because the government is still trying to regulate Bitcoin across the world. trying to regulate Bitcoin or other cryptocurrency with the currency regulations,
one last
which
comment.
Is not possible because the supply is not in accordance with the market. So
I get Dr. Bhatt, one last comment very briefly. I've got a message from Mayank Jain, and he says, I would like to know, what are the safeguards built in this distributed ledger system of Bitcoin to comply and uphold the sanctity and spirit of sanctions and curbing money laundering?
There are enough safeguards, but the thing is that as far as the government wants,
there's no inbuilt system.
Dr. Bhatt first, then Supreta.
Which is why a lot of illicit money is flowing.
Ponzi schemes and all that.
Yeah, one more. Dr. Bhatt first.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, Dr. Bhatt.
There is no inbuilt system which is there in such technology, which is why it is been misused and lot of illicit money is been stored in this currency. And there are many countries who have accepted it. Some countries have not accepted this as a legal tender, but the technology has no such feature of putting enabling a sanction or no. It's just that if you are in a country where it is not acceptable, like India says it's not a legal tender, I can't give a Bitcoin and buy a flat or a car or something like that.
Yeah.
But I can very well, sell a Bitcoin in Singapore and get money in Singapore dollar because Singapore allows transactions in Bitcoin.
Okay. Right. Thank you very much. Running out of time. We are going to continue this Bitcoin special all through the week. So you will have ample amount of time to speak on this issue. Thanks so much.